Happy Friday, everyone, and welcome to WatchGuard Security Week in Review, a video podcast dedicated to quickly summarizing the biggest information and network security stories each week and to sharing some practical security tips along the way. I'm your host and all-around security nerd, Corey Nachreiner, and this is the episode for the week starting December 1st, 2014. If you live in the U.S., I hope you enjoyed last week's Thanksgiving holiday weekend. But because of that, I missed last week, so this episode will be a little longer with four big security stories that happened over the past few weeks. However, two of the stories I'll only cover in very bare minimum detail just to speed the episode along. The theme the past 2 weeks has been advanced attacks and breaches. Three different security research groups posted intelligence about some major advanced attack campaigns, and one company suffered a huge breach. So let me start with two advanced campaigns that I'm only going to cover in bare minimum detail. Let's start with Operation Cleaver. A research organization called Cylance disclosed Operation Cleaver, which in a nutshell is an alleged Iranian attack against companies and organizations in the Western Hemisphere. So basically, they're saying Iranian attackers have developed a cyber campaign and have specialized malware they're using to go after government entities, airports, industrial facilities, oil and gas, energy, and research institutes. And they released a big, long 82-page report detailing this campaign and saying why they're attributing this attack to Iran. And in this report, they even speculate that this is Iran's revenge for Stuxnet. Now, here's my thoughts on this report. It is an interesting report, so you can check it out in the link on our blog post, but it actually doesn't seem as advanced as some of the other things I'm going to be talking about. They go into some detail about the malware and the different tactics used by this group. Things like SQL injection, spear phishing, stuff like that. They even talk about the Trojan or botnet used, which is called Tiny Zbot. It sounds a lot like Zbot, which is Zeus. In fact, it seems to have the same capabilities. And they talk about a lot of custom tools used in the attack, but essentially these tools are very similar to off-the-shelf things, things like Netcat. And they take advantage of well-known vulnerabilities that people have been using for a long time. There's nothing in this particular paper that really screams of super advanced malware or any sort of new attack technique, just a group of attackers that are using lots of well-known techniques in very smart manual ways. Now, I'm not discounting this report, but ultimately I don't think it's quite as interesting as other stories. But if you're interested in Operation Cleaver, be sure to check out the link in the blog post. Next up is an attack campaign targeting Wall Street, or more specifically, an attack group that seems to be trying to benefit off of stock market trading. This actually is something called FIN4, and it comes from FireEye, the well-known security vendor and research group. And they have a paper which they released this week that outlines a very specific attack going after a lot of Wall Street trading houses, as well as 80-some other companies that might be trading their own stock on the public market. Now, this attack is very different and quite interesting. It's actually not a bad guy sending malware to you. Really, this attack takes place entirely over spear phishing with a few malicious documents. Essentially, the way this attack works is these bad guys are targeting very specific people at these 100 different companies and Wall Street organizations. These are C-level executives, scientists and researchers, lawyers, and people like that. And they're sending them very well-written emails that have to do with their company, maybe that have to do with a trade or company acquisition they're working on right now. And within this email, they have a document, which is actually some legitimate document associated with this company that the attack group might have stolen from the company. But here's where the attack comes in. If someone getting these spear phishing emails opens that document, it actually uses VBA, or Visual Basic for Applications, something that Office uses, so that it can pop up a fake window. And this fake window looks very similar to a Windows domain authentication. authentication or the type of authentication pop-up you would get if you were, say, authenticating to Outlook for web access. If the victim puts in his credentials, the VBA then, of course, sends these credentials to the command and control server via a web post command. So really, the spear phishing email and the document with the fake pop-up are just a way for these bad guys to get lots of legitimate people's email credentials. And these bad guys are not actually delivering malware. They don't seem to be delivering malware to all these victims. Rather, they want their legitimate email credentials because then the attackers then send emails to other people as though they're coming from a legitimate person. And these emails have to do with very specific things that have to do with, say, the company's research or a business acquisition or something that could affect the company's stock on the public stock market. So, of course, FireEye believes that these attackers are doing this sort of phishing not to get malware on the victims, but to send emails that might make the company do something or might make the company respond in a way that they'll get enough information, the bad guy will get enough information, that they can decide whether to buy or short a stock and make money from it. Anyways, this is a very interesting attack. FireEye themselves, and I am not sure that their speculation on why the attackers are doing this is correct, but it does seem quite likely. And it's quite interesting to see how these bad guys are just using spear phishing emails and very basic techniques that don't install malware on their victims to do some things that would affect a company's public stock. So if you're interested in that, be sure to also check out the FIN4 report linked in the blog post associated with this video. By the way, you might be wondering, what's the takeaway for the FIN4 attack? Well, a simple takeaway, by the way, is you can disable VBA macros in Office documents. Because this threat does use VBA macros, if you disable them, you are partially safe from this particular threat, though it uses other spear phishing tactics too. The other takeaway is just be aware of spear phishing. You know, spear phishing is really, really smart social engineering email. Bad guys have become better at tricking you. You should just be more suspect of any emails or documents in emails you receive, even if they come from people you trust. Just pay close attention to context, and if you're ever a little confused about an email, maybe you should contact the person that's supposedly sending it before you interact with anything they've sent. Now let's move on to the bigger stories, the first being a new APT or advanced persistent threat called RIGIN. RIGIN is a new threat that was disclosed first by Symantec and then very quickly by Kaspersky. Both those antivirus vendors have released big documents going over what they know about this long-term, seemingly nation-state malware campaign in lots of detail. And there's really a lot to cover in RIGIN. I'm not going to be able to cover it in this video. So if you want to know about it, I really highly recommend you read those papers. But let me summarize it for you as quickly as I can. Essentially, this is new malware that some of the malware has been dated as far back as 2003, but it was found in the public as late as 2008, and yet both Symantec and Kaspersky are both disclosing it now. Now, even though they're disclosing it now, Symantec, Kaspersky, and even other AV companies have said that they started finding it and seeing it and researching it around 2012, 2013, and they've withheld disclosing it because a lot of parts of this malware are still a mystery. So let me cover the highlights. First of all, this is typical nation-state targeting malware. The targets this malware seems to be found on are the usual suspects, things like, SCADA facilities, energy facilities, government contractors, military facilities, airports. So again, it seems very likely the threat actors are going after big political or nation-state targets. The most interesting aspect about RIGIN and what makes it really advanced and more sophisticated than your usual malware, in fact, a lot of the researchers say this is even more sophisticated than Stuxnet in some ways, is the fact that it uses a very staged loading mechanism. First of all, the dropper that initially delivers this malware is still unknown, whether it be an executable file that installs on your computer that you have to run, or whether this be some sort of exploit that doesn't leave a telltale sign on your computer but executes code in memory. memory, the AV researchers don't have that initial dropper file. They only have the initial stager in some of the later loading stages of this malware. And what do I mean by stage loading? Essentially, Regan loads itself in five stages. The only actual file or executable file on your computer is stage one. And really, the only thing this stage one executable does is load the additional stage. And to load the additional stage, it has to decrypt that stage. This second stage of the malware isn't actually an executable. It can be something that's stored, a key blob stored in your registry. It can be some data stored on an unmapped part of your hard drive that the bad guy accesses by accessing the specific raw part of your hard drive. Or other stages like stage three, which again is also encrypted, may be stored in other locations like extended file systems. So this malware loads itself and kind of builds itself on your computer in multiple stages. And more importantly, those stages are very encrypted, making it very hard for security researchers to actually analyze them. The malware also sets up a virtual file system store, and all the data it actually reads is in this virtual file system store. The later stages for this malware, stages 4 and 5, are really where it actually does stuff, where it can actually load modules for command and control, for decrypting stuff, for doing callbacks, for setting up proxies. And then stage 5 is all its payload information, where it has multiple payloads. It's very modular malware, so the actors controlling it can set up a keylog in one module, or they actually have very advanced modules. Like, they have a module that's designed to gain access to GSM systems. And these, of course, are mobile wireless systems. So the things that ISPs and mobile carriers use for wireless, one module is designed to actually access the systems that monitor mobile phones. And some of the commands it's capable of are turning call forwarding on and changing call forwarding settings. So if you have a tinfoil hat or thinking about nation states, that's a perfect module to allow a nation state to infiltrate some other mobile ISP and then maybe turn on call forwarding for someone's phone so that calls get forwarded through another phone first, allowing you to intercept calls and things like that and do all kinds of snooping activities. In fact, some of the other people that have commented on Regan have pointed out that some of the Belgian ISP hijacks that happened a few years ago probably used this Regan malware. Anyways, what this all translates to is because of this stage loading, it's very, very hard to find this malware. You know, host-based antivirus products looking for malware would have to recognize all five of the different stages of this malware and how they work together to really figure out what's going on. So it is a very interesting piece of malware. There's a lot more data on it. I just don't think I can cover it in a lot of detail in a video. So I really highly recommend you check out both Kaspersky and Symantec's report. It's very interesting. So what's the takeaway here? Well, actually, I don't think you're going to get infected by Regan. If you're a normal business out there, you won't be infected by Regan. This is a very targeted attack. However, things like the stage loading of this malware is going to trickle down to criminal groups. You know, people are going to be analyzing this particular threat for a while, and I suspect more and more bad guys are going to start to use its techniques. So you should definitely think about advanced threat detection capabilities. One good way of doing that is sandboxes. By the way, if you're a WatchGuard customer, we can say we can catch part of this Regan attack. You know, in Symantec's report, they list all kinds of indicators of compromise, and they have all kinds of pieces of this Regan malware, the different stages. And when I run those through APT blocker, we do trigger on those particular files. But the actual dropper is still unknown. The actual way the bad guy infiltrates the victim in the first place is still unknown. So there's still no guarantee you can totally protect yourself from Regan until we know more about it. But having advanced threat protection would definitely help. The biggest story this week is pretty obvious if you follow the news, since everyone's been talking about this and sharing more and more information, and it's been developing over the past 2 weeks. And that's the Sony Pictures hack. The week before our Thanksgiving vacation, news came out that Sony Pictures had been hijacked. And the news came out kind of weird. I first became aware of it because of a Reddit post. Someone claiming to be an ex-Sony employee said that a Sony employee contacted him and said that Sony Pictures had sent all their employees home. And it was because a lot of the computers in their network got this pop-up message coming from GOP, which stands for Guardians of Peace, basically saying, Sony, we've hacked you, and if you don't do something for us, which you'll know soon, we're going to disclose all kinds of details about you. And of course, that wallpaper also had a deadline saying, if you don't do something by this date, we will start disclosing materials and stuff. And we still don't really know what the supposed ransom or extortion to Sony is. In any case, that deadline passed, and at first it was a little quiet. We didn't know what happened. But over the Thanksgiving weekend, one interesting thing that happened is a lot of Sony Pictures movies came out at all the usual pirate repositories. Fury, a very well-received movie. But more importantly, some unreleased movies, some movies still not in theaters. Movies like Annie and other films that still aren't in theaters also were posted to pirate sites. And it hasn't been confirmed that's part of the breach, but it's quite interesting. This week, of course, we're learning a lot more. This week, a 25 gigabyte file was put on the Pirate Bay and many other torrent sites, which uncompresses the 40 gigabytes of tons and tons of information. There's Excel sheets that have huge password lists for YouTube passwords, Amazon account passwords, stuff like that. It has a ton of Sony financials, what everyone's being paid, what people in the movie that's coming out called The Interview, Seth Rogen and other actors are being paid. It has some embarrassing emails, like HR emails talking about a particular Sony employee that's dating on company time. So it's full of a wealth of lots and lots of stolen data. Another interesting thing is the malware associated with this seems to be wiper malware. Last year, there was the Dark Hotel and Shamoon campaign, two campaigns where the malware specifically was destructive. It deleted hard drives and even deleted master boot records, making Windows computers unbootable. Apparently, Sony has wiper malware in its network. There are reports from employees saying that's why they sent everybody home. In fact, this week, the FBI also sent an announcement to U.S. businesses, a secret announcement warning them of destructive malware targeting U.S. businesses. Now, the FBI hasn't related this to the Sony attack itself, but many other companies and leakers are actually saying the wiper malware is on Sony's network. The most flabbergasting news of the week, by the way, is some people, it started with a rumor from a site Recode that this could be a North Korean attack. And apparently that movie, The Interview, is a comedy movie about assassinating the dictator in North Korea. And apparently people think that North Korea is upset enough about that that they're actually attacking Sony for releasing the movie. Now, there really is no evidence to support this. But it is interesting that the wiper malware associated with this attack affected South Korea, and some alleged that it came from North Korea. All this said, the idea that North Korea is behind this attack is simply rumor and speculation. I would not put any sort of merit to that. It's possible, maybe it will turn out we find out that's true, but right now there's no real evidence to support it. In either case, this is a huge breach. You know, I might argue this is bigger than the other huge breaches we've been talking about. The Target breach, the Home Depot breach. This is probably going to be one of the most damaging breaches to a company in the history, simply because the wealth of financial information. You know, the media is now releasing stories sharing how much all kinds of people at Sony and their partners make, how much movies are making, how much Seinfeld reruns friends are making, all kinds of embarrassing HR information, and just the cost of sending all the employees home and telling them not to access Sony network is a very big financial business loss. In a nutshell, this is definitely the biggest story of the past 2 weeks, and I think we're going to continue to learn about this in the scope and impact of this breach for a long time. Things we don't really know is how the breach initially happened. I will say the malware associated with this breach did have some passwords and server IP addresses that were specific to Sony Entertainment hard-coded in the malware. So the bad guy, or the person behind this attack, had intimate knowledge of Sony's network already, which might lead one to believe that there was an insider associated with this breach. So do note it might be an inside attack. So what can we learn or take away from this? Well, there's really not a ton of new security tips yet, because until we know how the breach really happened, there's not a lot to learn. That said, I would think about destructive malware. I would be very, very concerned with backing up data quite a bit. If you don't have backups of all your critical data, you're in trouble. The next thing is you really need to think about protecting sensitive data. What's going to be horrible to Sony's reputation is they've suffered network breaches before. Other parts of their organization has. So to have huge password files just in clear text Excel lists containing so much data not stored in an encrypted fashion is just bad security. I think it's something that many organizations do. Simply because of time, resource, and money, there's probably a lot of unencrypted data that's very, very important in corporations. But if you take away one learning, it's that we really need to start doing a better job of locally protecting a lot of our most sensitive data. Anyways, it's a fascinating breach. I'm sure I'll be talking about it for weeks, or at least putting update links in our weekly post. So if you want to know more about it, be sure to check the blog post for this video, since all the links will be there as well. Well, that's it for this week's longer than normal video. But since I've actually been off the video for 2 weeks, there's a lot more stories than normal I simply haven't talked about, especially since there were these four big advanced threat stories that I had to cover. You know, PayPal had a big vulnerability in it. There's been zero day found in Windows Journal, and many, many other interesting stories. So be sure to check out the extra section in the blog post associated with this video, as there's just a lot of security stories that have come out the past few weeks that you might want to take a look at. As always, if you want to learn more about security and you want to follow this video regularly, be sure to subscribe to our blog. It's found at blog.watchguard.com. Simply enter your email into that blog and press subscribe, and we'll be sure to email you whenever we have a new post. You can also follow me personally on Twitter. I'm at SecAdept, or you can follow WatchGuard at WatchGuardTech. As always, thank you for watching, and here at WatchGuard, we're rooting for you.